in collaboration with the Cyprus Mail. This is the Cyprus News Digest with Rosie Charalambous.
Coming up on this week's programme, the Health Minister talks frankly about the implementation of Cyprus' National Health Service.
We expect to have some problems in the first 2, 3, 4 months, but I'm sure by September, October, the whole system will be up and running smoothly.
And we meet the author and journalist who recently presented his report entitled Uncertain Ground, Engaging with Europe's De Facto States and Breakaway Territories.
These are all territories forged out of conflict, forged out of a kind of failure to live in a common state, which encourages a breakaway with the support of what we call a patron state, Russia in the case of Abkhazia, Transnistria, Turkey in the case of Northern Cyprus.
We're just a few weeks away from the implementation of Stage 1 of GESI, which is, of course, our national health service here in Cyprus. It's been on the cards with the pot boiling for goodness knows how many years, but finally it looks like it's coming to fruition under the helm of our health minister, Konstantinos Ioannou. Konstantinos, you must be very relieved and very proud, actually, that finally we're at the last hurdle, are we? Is this really going to push off as planned? Because I've spoken over the last 15, 20 years to, I think, 5 or 6 of your predecessors, and they've all struggled. How is it going to work out on June the 1st?
First of all, let me clarify that I'm proud that we're implementing finally a national health insurance plan. Relieved, not yet, because I think the difficulties lie ahead of us, and we sure expect, definitely we're going to start 1st of June, because I still hear people arguing. When I see people in the street, they keep asking me, are we going to implement the plan or not? It's said it's by legislation, and the only way that it can be postponed or cancelled, let's say, is by changing legislation, which is not the intention of any political party in any case. So 1st of June, we're starting with the first phase. The message I want to pass on is that we're going to have a difficult first few months because of 2 factors. First of all, it's the biggest single major reform that we're going ahead as a government for the last 30, 40 years. And with any major change, there are always problems.
Teething troubles.
Yes. But apart from that, because we need to change the mentality of people, both the patients, but also on the supply side, that is the doctors, the nurses, the hospitals. It's a new plan. It needs a change of mentality. People will need to learn how it works, how to navigate in the system. It's pretty straightforward, but still. And we expect problems to arise. In any case, because of the, as I'm sure everybody is aware, the reaction of certain parties involved in the last few months, in the last couple of years, but it has been intensified in the last few months. We expect to have some problems in the first 2, 3, 4 months, but I'm sure by September, October, the whole system will be up and running smoothly.
So let's talk people a little bit through how it's going to work. 1st of June, I mean, we've all been paying our contributions now since the beginning of March, I think, and we have to register with a GP.
Yes.
But on the 1st of June, for outpatients, let's say accident and emergency at the hospitals, what happens? Do we just go as we would normally in an emergency situation? And when we get there, what's different?
Well, as you're aware, we're implementing the GESI in 2 phases. The first phase is for outpatients. What this involves is the introduction of the concept of the GP, the general practitioner, the family doctor, which is an important pillar of the whole plan, because each one will have to choose a personal doctor. For adults, it has to be a general practitioner or a pathologist, and for kids up until 15 years old, a pediatrician. The first point of contact, should you have a problem with your health, if it's not an emergency, will be your family doctor, your general practitioner. he can either solve the problem for you or he can refer you to a specialist, which is included also in the first phase, specialists, outpatients. So, for example, if you have a stomach ache, you go to a GP, he will either solve the problem or refer you to a gastroenterologist. You have the option of who to visit. He will not refer you to a specific one. He will give you a referral to visit a gastroenterologist. Then it's up to you to choose from the ones who participate in the system who you want to visit. So there's a freedom of choice. The medicines involved in these procedures are also covered. And this is basically the first phase. Emergencies and hospitalization is going to be covered in the second phase. It's not in the first phase. So let's assume you still have a problem with your stomach. You go to a general practitioner. He refers you to a gastroenterologist. And then he or she says you're going to need a surgery. That part is not covered in the first stage. That will come a year from now, 1st of June 2020. So for that part, you're going to still follow the same path you will be following now. If you have a private insurance, fine. If you are entitled to go to the public hospitals, fine. Or you pay out-of-pocket expenses.
So it's rolling out on the 1st of June. We'll assume that by then, because it's not very far away, everybody has registered with a GP and that they know how it works. Now, I read something recently that you're allowed to visit your GP only a certain number of times within the scheme, depending on your age. Can you clarify that for me? Because people with chronic conditions are probably going to need to visit more often than what's allowed. So what happens
there?
I'm
glad you raised this issue. The way we are going to reimburse the general practitioners is on a fixed amount per person per year, irrespective of the number of visits. That was the initial plan. A grievance of the general practitioners was that it wouldn't have been easy for them to stop unnecessary, let's say, visits. For example, if somebody is hypochondriac and wants to call up every week, it was up to the doctor to say to him or her, "You are fine, you don't need to visit me." So to alleviate this problem, to counter this problem, we came up, based on international standards, on the number of visits based on age. It depends on age. For example, for newborns, I think it's 10 or 12 visits a year. Should you exceed that number of visits, the doctor has the right to charge you €15 per visit. Is not obligatory, it's up to the doctor to charge. So some doctors may charge that €15, some may not.
But the doctor let me interrupt there. If the doctor charges me €15 because I'm over my limit of visits, let's say, the health scheme is not also paying him?
No. We are paying a fixed amount a year. So, for example, for kids, it's €150, if I remember correctly, that we're paying. So if I register a kid, a child, I will receive as a reimbursement from NHIO €150 per year. And that covers the 10 or 12 visits for that child.
Even if you only do 2 visits, you still get paid.
Yes, exactly. But the amount, the way it's going to be calculated is going to be based on a number of, on the whole amount of kids on the visits. It's not going to be on a particular case by case, if I'm not wrong. The important thing is that people with chronic diseases are not included in this. So people with chronic diseases, the doctors will not be eligible to charge them the extra amount. They are not included in this scheme. So they can visit any number of times they want.
But that would presumably mean that the GP would have to, in a sense, register the fact that they have a chronic condition and are likely to exceed the number of visits.
But that's a matter of the logistics of the system, of the architecture of the system, which is doable. I mean, it's in any case, if somebody has a chronic disease, it will be registered in the system anyway through the GP.
And the GP will get paid for those extra visits by the health scheme?
For the extra visits for the chronic? No. Yeah. The National Health Insurance Organization will pay a fixed amount.
But there's danger there, is there not, that doctors will try to avoid accepting on their books people with chronic conditions because they're going to end
like
up having to see them without getting paid?
People with chronic diseases, it's not the GP that they need. It's a specialist that deal with their diseases. For example, if you have a neurological disease, you'll visit your neurologist. And even for that, And usually people with chronic diseases, they visit their specialist every 15, 20 days. So imagine if they had to go to their GP to give them a referral. For chronic diseases, they get 6 to 12 months referrals. So you visit one, your GP, if you have a chronic disease. For example, if you suffer from thalassemia, and I know this from personal experience from friends of mine, they need to visit their cardiologist every month and various other specialists on a monthly basis. For these patients, the GP will give them a 6 to 12 month referral. So they don't need to go every time to get a referral to go to the cardiologist. So they don't put excess demand, let's say, for visits to the GP.
Let's come now to the doctors and the clinics that have signed up. A few weeks ago, it was looking a bit dodgy in some areas that there may not be enough cover. And I think in this week's paper, it says you're feeling quite confident now, but there are areas where there are gaps. So what's going to happen if June the 1st comes along and you don't have the number of doctors that you think you need to cover the population actually signed up on the books?
I don't think that's a scenario. In any case, we need the number of general practitioners to start. The specialist, we also bear in mind that the doctors working now for the public hospital, the Thomas Hospital, are going to be in the system anyway. We know for a fact that we'll not have the numbers, the ideal amount of we plan for, let's say. In any case, in all the systems, health systems that have started in any country in the last 20, 30 years, and this has been the advice of the advisory company that we have on board, the consultants that we have on board, is that 20 to maximum 30% of the doctors sign up day one, and within a year, 90% of them sign up. And this is part of the what we said at the beginning of the interview, of the big change. If I put myself in the shoes of a doctor, you know, it's such a big change, you may not trust the system. So you need to see how it works. And I'm sure as the weeks go by, not months go by, we'll see a big inflow of doctors registering. So we know for a fact that from day one, we will not have the amount that we plan or dreamed of. But we hopefully will have the amount to be able to offer a satisfactory kind of, let's say, service to the people. But I want to let it know from now to the citizens of the Republic of Cyprus, the people that do not expect that from day one. That's why I stressed from the beginning of the interview we're going to have problems. We may need 100 cardiologists and have only 10. So day one, people will still have problems. There must still be delays in finding an appointment. But as the weeks go by, more and more will sign up. We are definite about that. So I want to warn beforehand that we're going to have problems. It's not going to be from day one, the system as we dreamed of and planned of, but definitely in the next few months, that would be the case.
So let's just assume, following that up, that I need a cardiologist, you do only have 10, so I'm, going to phone around the 10 cardiologists in the system, none of them can see me maybe for 3 months perhaps.
No,
I mean, that's
that
not
be.
Unheard of in, for example, other countries where, unless it's an absolute emergency, you wait your turn. Mm-hmm. But then what do I do if I feel I really do need to see a doctor? I just go and pay myself? To a private doctor isn't in the system?
I guess it's a choice that each one will have to make. But what I want to reassure is that we're going to have these kind of problems, maybe in some specialties at the beginning, but you can imagine that those 10 doctors that enter the system are going to have so much work that the rest of them will see that it's doable, will see the advantages of the system and will register more and more doctors as the weeks pass by. So definitely the first few weeks will not have the sufficient numbers that we want to, but as the weeks pass by, we will.
Are there any areas where you think that your ministry, working with the health insurance organisation, needs to perhaps prioritise something that may have been missed or that isn't quite how you would want it?
Because I'm a perfectionist, nothing is quite as I wanted it to be. And the civil service, we have their own way of moving forward, their own rhythm, which is not what I would like to. But as far as medicine is concerned, because everybody's talking about doctors, but a big also offering of the system is medicines. And as you know, we already have an agreement with pharmacists. And as of next week, we will have a pretty confident agreement with the pharmaceutical companies. So that big part of the equation of the offering is being solved. So you may get delays, let's say, the first few weeks with your doctor, or you may not, we may not have the right amount of general practitioners, but as far as medicines, which is the big part of the equation, it's going to be up and running from day one. That's at least the reassurance we can give.
And you'll get your medicines where? From the local pharmacy in your neighbourhood?
Yes.
Do you pay for them?
It depends.
On?
On, like all systems, if there is a generic substitution for a medicine, if it's medicines that there is only one, that's it. You pay only €1 for the prescription. If there is a generic substitution, that is there is no patent, which is a case in many medicines nowadays.
And they're cheaper.
They are cheaper. All of them are cheaper. The NHIOS will reimburse the cheapest. If the chemical substance, let's say, is the same for the same kind of medicine. For example, in cholesterol, there are maybe 3 or 4 kind of medicines. We will reimburse, as long as this for the same illness and the same chemical substance, all systems reimburse the cheapest one.
Okay, when you say reimburse, am I paying
you're not paying anything. The system will reimburse out of the three. You go to the pharmacist, and the pharmacist will say, if you go with pharmacy with medicine A, is free. If you go with medicine B, which is €5 more expensive, you have to pay the difference only. If you go with the third one, which is €7 more expensive, you only pay the difference. So it's up to you to decide if you want to go with the branded one, which is more expensive, rather than the one which is zero reimbursed by the NHIOS.
But I'm not actually going to hand over money to the pharmacist unless I want one of the expensive ones.
Exactly, yes. You're going to hand only €1 for the prescription.
And let's quickly talk, if we may, about nurses, midwives, those other sort of peripheral things.
Those are coming in the second phase. They're not covered in they're not included in the first phase. They're part of the hospitalisation coming in the second phase.
So we'll talk about that next year.
Yes, hopefully.
That's our Health Minister, Konstantinos Ioannou, who is in the final leg of getting our National Health Service up and running.
You can subscribe to the Cyprus News Digest on iTunes for free and get the program downloaded to your phone or tablet so you can listen anytime, anywhere.
My next guest was in Cyprus recently for a report that he's written entitled Uncertain Ground, Engaging with Europe's De Facto States and Breakaway Territories. He is journalist and author Thomas de Waal. He joins us now. Thomas, first of all, can you outline what you were talking about? Because there are so many de facto states these days that we probably don't even think of in those terms. And, of course, we know all about breakaway territories in Cyprus.
Yes, well, I spent a lot of my journalistic career in bits of the former Soviet Union, in Chechnya, about which I wrote a book about Nagorno-Karabakh. I also wrote a book about that. But none of those included in this report. I'm looking at three, basically, territories which fit the criterion that they are kind of long-running, fairly long-sustained self-governing territories, that they are not about to collapse, that they look like they will endure in the future, but also unlikely to be recognised widely internationally. So the three I chose were Abkhazia, broke away from Georgia, or more or less Soviet Georgia in 92-93, Transnistria, broke away from Moldova at the same period, and Northern Cyprus. I also have a chapter on Ukraine, but that's more of a counter-example of about a kind of emerging de facto state, which I don't think is going to survive in the long term.
Are there any similarities between those that you mention in the report in terms of what caused them to break away? I mean, that's the bottom line to start with, isn't it? Why did they want to do that in the first place?
Well, obviously, these are all territories forged out of conflict, forged out of a kind of failure to live in a common state, which encourages a breakaway. with the support of what we call a patron state, Russia in the case of Abkhazia, Transnistria, Turkey in the case of northern Cyprus. So there are definite commonalities there. There are also differences. Abkhazia is very, very stubborn on trying to get international recognition. Transnistria and northern Cyprus, less so. In both those places, they seek an accommodation with Moldova and the Republic of Cyprus, respectively, even though there's not been a full solution.
How far do ethnic or religious factors play a part in, again, that underlying separation?
In some cases, quite a lot. I would say the Abkhaz-Georgian conflict is really an ethnic conflict, with those very kind of deeply held nationalist, national passions which divide people, their views of history and so on. And obviously there's an ethnic dimension, it is an ethnic framework, let's call it, to the Cyprus conflict. Transnistria, it's basically a kind of political conflict between two elites, one more pro-Russian, one kind of more pro-Moldovan, but there's no ethnic component there.
And where are these, I suppose we could call them dead conflicts, going? Because it's just there. We often talk about Cyprus and the fact that we have UN peacekeepers here. Do we actually need them? Because really there have been no shots fired in anger for a long time. I've been to Transnistria and gone through the checkpoints from Moldova. Mm. There are, it seems to me, some similarities. But I wonder whether there's any progression in any of these places towards, in Cyprus we want a solution, or some of us do. Do they in these other areas? I didn't get the feeling that in Transnistria, for example, they seem fairly happy with the status quo.
Yes, I mean, I think this is definitely another characteristic, that these are protracted conflicts, protracted disputes almost, which are unlikely to flare back into violent conflict, but with no prospect of a quick solution, which is why in my report I'm very much advocating the idea of engagement. This is the kind of key word, that I think within a framework of non-recognition, that these places are not going to be recognised as international states, there's a lot more that could be done to engage with the societies, with the people there, and also on certain topics, one has to be careful, on certain topics with the de facto authorities there, and that, for example, in education, health, environment, there's a lot more that you can do there to just make life more normal there and have this sort of slow convergence, alignment between the breakaway and the recognised state, which hopefully over time will contribute to a kind of resolution from below rather than above.
When you say a resolution, though, are you talking about unbreaking away the state, or are you talking about eventual recognition? Because things like trade as well, I mean, you spoke about the human aspect of things, but in an unrecognised state, I presume trade is quite difficult, and therefore the standard of living is probably not as high as perhaps its inhabitants would want it to be. So those are just some of the problems. Should we be aiming, and are the powers that be globally aiming, at bringing these breakaway states back into where they were?
I'm going to surprise you by saying I don't really take a stand on that issue. I just think that that really is up to the parties to the conflict to decide. And I don't think that's a cop-out, because I do think that each case will be different. I do think that Abkhazia, for instance, there is perhaps a prospect in the future of recognition with the consent of Georgia, but only with the consent of Georgia. Here I see it as pretty unlikely that there would be a independent Turkish Cypriot state, again, only with the consent of the Greek Cypriots. You know, that there's this idea, the International Crisis Group idea, that there would be two parallel independent states inside the EU. I don't really take a position on that. I think it's very much for the parties themselves to decide what suits them. But the more they converge de facto, the more, for example, there's a kind of Europeanization in the north, again, a de facto Europeanization, the easier it will be eventually for a new generation to come along and say, oh, hey, we're pretty close on lots of issues, let's kind of converge politically as well. Then, of course, there is the elephant in the room, which is the patron state, Russia or Turkey, and that element really is the unknowable one, to what extent the geopolitics align to make these conflicts resolvable. But, you know, these conflicts exist on various levels. So there's the geopolitical dimension, which ordinary people can't do much about, and then there's the local dimension, which they can do.
And then there's the personalities of the leaders involved, and they can change, of course. Not the personalities, I mean the leaders. And in these long-running affairs, you do find that there are different leaders at different times who may come at the problem, if you want to call it that, from a totally different angle.
That's right. But you have to be quite lucky, in my experience, to get two leaders at the same moment who are prepared, who kind of have a kind of shared vision that they want to move forward. And to an extent, you've had that maybe possibly with Anastasiadis and Akinji here in Cyprus, but again, it didn't align on other issues. Certainly Cyprus, for someone who studies conflicts like Abkhazia, is actually a fairly positive example in the extent of people-to-people contacts, in the fact there is quite a strong peace constituency here. You know, one comes to Cyprus as someone who studies other conflicts and one sees a more civilized approach. One still sees a conflict with all its traumas and all its legacies, but, you know, you see more respect between the sides than you do in other places, at least.
And if we come back to the geopolitics, if you look at the wider region and energy in particular, Russia and Turkey both have their own very distinct ambitions in terms of how that pans out in the region. How much does that affect these smaller conflicts?
Well, obviously, it's part of the geopolitics. I'm not really so familiar. I know that there's a lot of discussion about Eastern Mediterranean hydrocarbons and how that changes things. I'm more familiar with the energy situation in Caucasus, Armenia, Azerbaijan, and so on. All I can say is that a clever negotiator from a big state like the United States can use that as leverage, you know, to try and get the two sides to agree on a mutually beneficial energy deal. But again, that relies on a certain kind of diplomat, and unfortunately, I think, you know, we're seeing a retreat of the US, for example, from kind of world diplomacy at the moment, which isn't very helpful.
We've been talking to author and journalist Thomas de Waal, who was in Cyprus recently to present his report, Uncertain Ground, Engaging with Europe's De Facto States and Breakaway Territories.
Keep up to date with events in Cyprus and around the world with the Cyprus News Digest.
And in other news this week, the new governor of the Cyprus Central Bank was sworn in. Konstantinos Erodotou is replacing Kristal Layorkagi, the former Auditor General, who's been really rather unseen during her five-year tenure. At the swearing-in ceremony, President Anastasiadis said that our aim is none other than to meet the justified demands of the public for good governance, meritocracy, transparency, and most importantly, upgraded service. Well, that's rather ironic because on Tuesday, the House Energy Committee was told by Energy Minister Yorgos Lagotribis that the opening up of the energy market has once again been pushed back. This time, the new date is December 2021. Deadlines to liberalise the market have come and gone. The first was 2016, then we had 2018, 2019, 2020, and now, apparently, 2021. Tellingly, the head of the energy regulator, Andreas Bouligas, said that they no longer have confidence in the TSO, that's the transmission system operator, who is tasked with deploying specialised software to monitor supply and demand. And they say they can't meet the deadlines, even though they have, as you've just heard, been pushed back several times. At present, the only producer of electricity in Cyprus is the state-run power company, the EAC. Currently, independent electricity producers can only sell to the EAC, but under the liberalised system, which was agreed many years ago, producers, for example, of renewable energy sources would be able to sell on the market freely. And, of course, then one might expect the price of electricity on the island to fall. Well, that about wraps up this edition of the Cyprus News Digest. Many thanks for your company. Hope you'll join me next week. Till we meet again, take care and God bless. Bye-bye now.